Press, press, let's go, let's go.
The longest day of Bill Clinton's campaign for president started before dawn, Monday. The first stop, a diner in Philadelphia.
Thank you. Thanks.
It's the day before the election.
Back at Clinton headquarters in Little Rock, campaign staffers are gearing up for what will be their last day in the war room.
Thousands of people waiting for Clinton this morning outside of the Philly diner in the rain. Looks absolutely great on TV this morning.
I have 9 cities to go, but remember, on the last day of this great campaign to change America, I started it in the city where America began much of its future, Philadelphia. Goodbye. I love you.
The next stop, Cleveland. From the plane, Governor Clinton checks in with his staff at campaign headquarters in Little Rock.
Are we still ahead in the poll in Arizona?
It's tight, but it's possible.
It is an emotional time for me. I'm very nervous. I'm very hopeful. I know it's not a done deal, and I get very nostalgic about my friend of 20 years, maybe being elected president of this country.
In Cleveland, Clinton, hoarse from delivering too many speeches, addresses his second rally of the day.
I have nearly lost my voice trying to give you a voice in Washington on Tuesday.
Why is he talking?
Because he can't help himself.
The voice. The voice sounds all right this morning.
Well, the voice is making remarkable comebacks at every landing,
yeah.
You know, because it's very shaky. But it's okay. He's going to be fine.
Enthusiastic crowds at a campaign rally are often an illusion. Most of them are generated by the campaigns themselves. Professionals depend on more reliable indicators.
These are my lucky charm, these gloves. Got to keep my hands clean and pure so when I touch the victory.
We were just talking at the other end of this thing with your partner. And you were kidding with me about it before. He is apparently now going to be wearing black gloves between now.
Is that his latest?
Yes, that's his latest. So do you want
to? Better than not changing his underwear.
So do you want to show us what you've got here?
Here we go.
This is your.
This is my De Guayo tie, the Mexican death sign.
The Mexican death sign.
Which
all
is.
Right. And why are you wearing that tie?
No prisoners, no mercy, no quarter. We don't want to coast into this, man. We just want to drive a stake through their heart.
All right. Tell me what the point of this thing is. And when I say this thing, I mean 8 stops. Is it 8 stops?
9.
Or 9 stops? 9 stops between now and tomorrow morning at this
time.
We
generally do it because, again, a candidate is too wired to sleep usually. The staff is usually wired. And also, you do have the benefit of firing people up.
Then it's back on the plane. The subject on everyone's mind, Clinton's lead in the polls.
CNN has it at 8. ABC has it at 7.
If you took all the polls that are out there, the NBC, our polls, CNN's polls, they'd all average out around 7 or 8 points. I think you could be fairly comfortable with that.
Children shouldn't play with matches. Media people shouldn't play with polls. They're dangerous things. They blow up in your face.
One of the things that has struck all of us in this campaign is the importance of a candidate trip into a state. There is an immediate effect, 2 points, maybe even 3 points in some cases. So, it's almost like a football game. Who gets the ball last can make a difference. And that can turn a narrow defeat into a narrow victory.
Another stop, another rally. The third of the day, this time in Detroit.
How do you do it? Must be really fatigued.
It's the last lap, man.
It is just after 4:30 in the afternoon. The campaign is already more than 10 hours old, and it is not yet half over. We are in St. Louis. It is cold, it is drizzling, and it is miserable. It is as though Governor Clinton has made a compact with the American public. If they will only vote for him tomorrow, he will subject himself to one more day of as much pain as humanly possible.
The speeches and rallies are simply the most visible part of the campaign. As reporters covering Clinton's final effort file their stories, the candidate has not a moment to himself. First, he is interviewed by Tom Brokaw in New York.
You've been at this business a long time. What do you think now as you look ahead of the next 24 hours as you look back over the past 13 months?
First, I feel enormous gratitude. Gratitude to the American people who believed in me enough to let me keep fighting for the ideas, for the changes that I think America has to embrace.
In the time that is left, before departure from St. Louis, another round in the endless cycle of autographs, handshakes, and photographs. And then, out of nowhere, amidst the chaos, a gem-like moment.
For the land of the free.
And then it's back to work. The Clinton Marathon touches down in Paducah, Kentucky.
No more this! No more this! No more this!
This is the fifth stop I have made today. We began in Pennsylvania. We went to Ohio. We went to Michigan.
Pennsylvania has a governor who's not supporting us. Ohio has a Republican governor. Michigan has a Republican governor. And Missouri has a Republican governor. And so we have to be there to make sure that to counteract the infrastructure in those states.
By this time, almost everyone is having a hard time focusing. The media is bored by the repetitive speeches, and everyone is showing fatigue, except Bill Clinton.
It's an interesting thing. I had a little last-minute campaign argument with my staff about this.
About whether to come here?
Yeah, because they said, but it's not a big media market. I said, you don't understand. Wendell Ford and Bretton Jones said we have to go there because we've not been there. And we can carry Kentucky if we do. And it touches Southern Illinois, where we're strong, Tennessee. It touches Indiana. It touches Missouri. It's multi-state impact. It's the biggest crowd we've had today.
Not only that, but behind those lights, I don't know if you can see them, there's just one satellite truck after another and one dish after another.
Oh, yeah, we got all the media from all these states. It was great. It's great.
Back on the plane and energized by his reception, Clinton calls the war room for a little I told you so with his advisors, who had urged him to pass over Paducah.
Hello? They're nervous for that.
Hey, Governor!
Hey!
Does this mean you think it's time for a change in America?
Does this mean you think your candidate was right in going to Paducah against all advice?
I'm proud of you. I'm grateful to you.
Come see me when I get home in the morning. I want you to be the candidate.
Thank you all. We're going to McAllen. Good night.
The call interrupts the last war room meeting of the campaign.
You know, I was kidding James yesterday. I said he's about to pass from the role of regular human being into the role of a legend. And I think he really deserves it. Because probably for the first time in a generation tomorrow, we're going to win. And that means that more people are going to have better jobs. People are going to pay a little less for health care, get better care. And more kids are going to go to better schools. So, thanks.
Back when I became a Democrat, and the way this party was really founded, and I think we forget it sometimes, is there's a simple doctrine. Outside of a person's love, the most sacred thing that they can give is their labor. And somehow or another along the way, we tend to forget that. And labor is a very precious thing that you have. And any time that you can combine labor with love, you've made a merger. And I think we're going to win tomorrow. And I think that the governor is going to fulfill his promise and change America. And I think many of you are going to go on and help him. I'm a political professional. That's what I do for a living. I'm proud of it. We changed the way campaigns are run. And people are going to tell you you're lucky. You're not. Ben Hogan said golf is a game of luck. The more I practice, the luckier I get. The harder you work, the luckier you are. I was 33 years old before I ever went to Washington, New York. I was 42 before I ever won my first campaign. And I'm happy for all of y'all. You've been part of something special in my life. Now, never forget what y'all have done. Thank you.